Welcome to our service for Lent 3. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
O Lord, open our eyes to your presence, open our minds to your grace, open our lips to your praises, open our hearts to your love, open our lives to your healing.
And be found among us.
Amen.
Thank you.
We come seeking forgiveness for all that we have failed to be and do as members of Christ's body. In God, there is forgiveness.
Loving and all-seeing God, forgive us.
Where we have fallen short of your image in us, where we have failed to support one another and be what we claim to be, where we have failed to serve you, where our thoughts and actions fail to reflect your love, we ask your pardon. God forgives us. Be at peace. Rejoice and be glad, for Christ is the resurrection and offers reconciliation for the whole human race. We shall be one in Christ, one in our life together. Praise to God who has created us, accepted us, and who sends us into the world. Let us pray. Almighty God, whose most dear Son went not up to joy, but first he suffered pain, and entered not into glory before he was crucified, mercifully grant that we, walking in the way of the cross, may find it none other than the way of life and peace, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen. As we prepare to explore God's word, let us pray together. May God guide each of us in the way of Christ, whatever our age or experience. May the love of God speak to us all. Our New Testament lesson is from Romans chapter 4. Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand. And we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that sufferings produce endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. Indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person someone might actually dare to die. But God proves his love for us, in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Much more surely then, now that we have been justified by his blood, will we be saved through him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his Son, much more surely, having been reconciled, will we be saved by his life. But more than that, we even boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
From those forever. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
My children, I will be with you only a little while longer. You will look for me, and just as I have told the Jews, so I tell you now, where I am going, you cannot come. A new commandment I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. Simon Peter asked him, Lord, where are you going? Jesus replied, where I am going you cannot follow now, but you will follow later. Peter asked, Lord, why can't I follow you now? I will lay down my life for you. Then Jesus answered, will you really lay down your life for me? Very truly, I tell you, before the rooster crows, you will disown me three times. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
May I speak in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Some of you may have noticed over the last year or so, I've been trying to change my sermons a little to become more like teaching. I know that for some of you that's been helpful, and I would like, if possible, for you to give me some feedback. A young married couple, David and Fiona, not their real names, who I married some years ago, were having some marriage problems. When they came to see me, it became clear after a lot of discussion that their problems were nothing to do with the love that they had for each other, but just how they thought of love and how they communicated their love. David worked late almost every night, and Fiona thought it was because he didn't want to be at home. David felt that Fiona really didn't want to spend time with him, as she seemed to spend much of her time in the kitchen doing the ironing. As we talked, Fiona said, I'm so afraid that you don't love me anymore. David looked horrified and exasperated. I work late every day, even though I'm tired out, just so that I can buy you lovely things, because I love you so much. And when I get home, all you want to do is be in the kitchen ironing. Fiona burst into tears. I hate ironing, she said. I only do it to make sure that you have everything you want to wear, just when you want it, just like my mum used to for my dad. Love can be a confusing thing, can't it? Just what is love? How do I know if I'm in love or if I'm acting in love? How do I know if others love me? Love is the most important thing in our lives. It is the key to happiness. And all the love that we share with one another has its source in God. As you know so well, we use the word love a lot, but it's often overused, misused, and misunderstood. According to Amazon, there are 145,000 books that deal with the subject of love. There are over 11,000 popular CDs with love in the title. So we can see that love is an important subject to all of us. But do we really know what love is? First of all, let's consider some wrong ideas about love. The first false idea about love is that love equals romance. Many people move from one relationship to another and describe them all as love. But were they really in love? Most of the popular songs of any generation have to do with so-called love. The most popular love songs are about romance, but romance and love are not the same thing. A second false idea about love is that it is this lovely feeling, an emotion, which is a bit of a fuzzy or gives you goosebumps. But if love is only a feeling, then what happens when the feelings come and go? A final idea about love is love never means having to say you're sorry. I'm dating myself by illustrating this point with the 1970 classic film Love Story, starring Ali McGraw and Ryan O'Neill. The famous line from the film is, "Love means never having to say you're sorry." In other words, love means never being critical or having accountability. So if that is not what love is, then what is love? Let me begin to define love by telling a story that many of us can relate to. Jeff, a college student, sees Meg for the first time and his mouth drops open in amazement. He's never seen anyone so beautiful. His heart begins to race, his mouth goes dry and his palms sweat. All he wants to do is get close to her and meet her. He finally gets up the courage to introduce himself and they talk for a few minutes. For the next 2 weeks, Jeff can't eat, sleep or study. He plans his day around bumping into Meg accidentally. They meet for lunch a couple of times and he calls her and they talk. On the first official date, they hold hands in the film. After getting to know Meg better, Jeff is even more impressed and captivated. And then finally, one moonlit night, after numerous dates, Jeff blurts out, "Meg, you are so amazing, and I have to tell you that I love you." Meg says, "I love you too." It's obvious that Jeff and Meg are falling in love, but what kind of love are they experiencing? If your answer is romantic love, then you were right. There are at least four kinds of love in human relationships. C.S. Lewis, in his well-known book, The Four Loves, identifies them by their Greek names, Eros, Philia, Storge, and Agape. Storge is love that is expressed in family relationships and is a special kind of love. Today, I want to just focus on the other three. So let's start with Eros. We might remember Eros by the song You Make Me Feel So Good. Eros is a more self-centered type of love that focuses more on the pleasure gained than the pleasure given in a relationship, although other types of love may come into play later. Eros is love that pleases the senses. Jeff pursued Meg because it made him feel good. At its very worst, Eros is animalistic and lustful. And at its best, it is a deep physical and emotional longing for someone. Now, there's nothing wrong with being in love. In the best sense, Eros can be a foundation for a lasting and healthy marriage. But couples must also set about the task of establishing a relationship based on something more than attraction. If the love between a man and a woman is going to flourish, then it must expand from self-satisfying romantic eros to another satisfying love. The second kind of love is called philia, or friendship love. You can remember philia by the statement, "You've got a friend." Consider four friends who meet every Saturday, rain or shine, and play chess. The four friends talk during their games, but the subject matter is usually about chess. Occasionally they talk about their careers or about their children and grandchildren, or argue about politics, but pretty quickly everything turns back towards chess. If these men didn't have chess in common, they probably wouldn't have met in the first place, or having met, they wouldn't have become friends. Friendship love, or philia, is a relationship of mutual admiration, a and give and take based on common interests. Lewis writes, friendship must be about something, even if it were only an enthusiasm for dominoes or white mice. Those who have nothing can share nothing. Those who are going nowhere have no fellow travellers. Philia is less self-centred than Eros, but if one member takes too much and gives too little, the friendship may be on shaky ground. Friends take care of each other when the need arises, but that's not principally why friends are friends. Friends come together over a common task, idea, activity, cause, or experience. If the common interest between friends ceases to exist, a higher level of love must become active to keep friends together. For example, when one of the chess players, Walter, suffered a debilitating stroke, two of the others felt sorry for him, but they never went to see him. They were more concerned about finding a new fourth for their chess matches. One, however, Peter, visited Walter in hospital. And when Walter went home, Peter visited him two or three times a week. Walter could no longer play chess with his friend. In fact, he couldn't even talk about chess, having completely lost his ability to speak. Peter's love for his friend had reached a new level, a sacrificial love that demands nothing in return, which is the last kind of love I want us to think about. The highest form of love is called agape. It is a love without strings, or in other words, agape love is unconditional love. Agape love is that God, it's from God and is God. It is a love that gives without demand or return. It is a love that makes the health, happiness and growth of others as important to us as our own. It is a love that is committed to provide and protect. One person defined it like this: agape is giving someone what they need the most when they deserve it the least at great personal cost. Added to Eros, agape can transform a romance into a dynamic, fulfilling marriage. Added to philia, agape can transform a common friendship into a deep and meaningful bond. C.S. Lewis calls agape a gift love. God's gift love was supremely demonstrated in the gift of his Son given for our redemption. But Lewis describes two kinds of agape that humans exercise. The first kind, Lewis calls human gift love, which is our best attempt to love unselfishly and sacrificially, which on a human level is limited. The second kind, Lewis calls divine gift love, which is the very love of God, the indwelling God, of love working in us and through us to protect and provide for other people. Only God's divine love can allow us to love anyone and everyone without strings attached. Lewis says that God's divine love allows us to love what is not naturally lovable: lepers, criminals, enemies, the sulky, the superior and the sneering. It is to this level of love that Christ calls us when he said, "Love your enemies and love each other as I have loved you." I want to conclude today's sermon by pointing out that ultimately love is a verb. If you look in the dictionary, you will see that love is listed as a noun, not a verb. But what I want us to realise is that love is not something that comes over us against our will. Rather, we need to realise that the highest form of love is a decision. It is a choice. It is a commitment. The highest form of love, agape, is a decision to act in the most loving way possible. A man named Henry Grady said it like this: "There is no such thing as love. There is only somebody who loves. Love, this thing called love, does not exist in heaven or on earth or in any secret corner of creation. It exists only when somebody loves and only in somebody's act of loving. There is no love. There is only the lover." What is love really? It is a decision, a choice, and a commitment. It is a verb, it is action, behaviour, and demonstration. Are you willing to receive God's love in your life and put it into practice? Amen.
Him shall not wait for the poor to lose their patience, the scorned to smile, the despised to find a friend. Jesus is Lord, he has championed the unwanted. In him injustice confronts its timely end. Him shall not wait for the rich to share their
Let us affirm our faith in Jesus Christ, the Son of God.
Though he was divine, he did not cling to equality with God, but made himself nothing, taking the form of a slave. He was born in human likeness. He humbled himself and was obedient to death on the cross. Therefore God has raised him on high and given him the name above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow and every voice proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
Amen.
And so let us pray. The response to hear us is, hear us, good Lord. Gracious God, fountain of all wisdom, we pray for all Christian people, for Stephen, our Archbishop, John, our Bishop, and for those who teach and guard the faith. May the word of Christ dwell richly in our hearts and knit us together in the bond of your love. Hear us, good Lord. We pray for the leaders of the nations and for those in authority under them. Give them the gift of your wisdom and a right discernment in all things. Hear us, good Lord. We pray for our parishes, for all who live and work locally, and for all who visit. Speak your word of peace in our midst and help us to serve one another as Christ has served us. Hear us, good Lord. We pray for those bowed down with grief, fear, or sickness. We continue to remember the people of Ukraine, for those separated from loved ones by the war, and for the people of Syria and Turkey, and for all those who are struggling with the impact of natural disasters, and for the work of all aid agencies. May your living word bring comfort and healing to all those in need. Hear us, good Lord. We give thanks for all those who have died in the faith of Christ, and we rejoice with St. Edith, St. Andrew, St. Mary, and all your saints, trusting in the promise of your word fulfilled. Lord of the Church, hear our prayer, and make us one in heart and mind. Hear us, good Lord. And we commend our prayers, those spoken out loud and those in our hearts, as we pray together. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever.
Amen.
Living one, Creator and lover of the world,
we offer our lives to you this day,
and our life together in you.
Accept us as we are, with all our stumbling and all our courage.
Guide us into what you would have us to be,
and in the power of the Spirit, enable us to be a sign of your presence in the world.
In the name of Jesus, your loving Son.
Amen.
The blessing of God, ground of being, bread of life and spirit of peace, rest upon you and all whom you love, both living and departed, now and always.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ. Amen.
Oh Lord, your tenderness melting all my bitterness. Oh Lord, I receive your Oh, I receive your Lord, I receive.